السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك عليه وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى أصحابه وأحبابه ومن استنى بسنته واقتفى أثره ودعا بدعوته إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. So my brothers and sisters, it is my pleasure to be with you in this university. It is not my first time to visit you. I was with you last year. And I expected to be asked to speak about Ramadan since we are 4 or 5 days from Ramadan. But the brothers asked me to speak about the hour, the last day, the day of resurrection, which is part of our aqidah, part of our iman, part of our creed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to believe in 6 articles of faith: to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe in His books, to believe in His angels, to believe in His prophets and messengers, to believe in the faith and decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to believe in the last day, the day of resurrection. So learning about the day of resurrection or the hour or the last day is part of your faith. Your iman is not complete and not valid and not accepted if you do not believe in the resurrection day. And the disbelievers, the idol worshippers and the atheists, the difference between us and them, that they don't believe in Allah and they don't believe in the last day. They don't believe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. The one who disbelieve in Allah and His angels and His books and His messengers on the last day, he is misguided a great misguidance. And talking about the Day of Judgment, we have information in the Quran, information in the Ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And there are discussions among the scholars regarding the order of the incidents that will happen in the Day of Judgment. So this order that you will hear from me is opinion of majority of scholars to see this incident in this order. But you may hear from others a different order, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned what going to happen in the Day of Judgment, but it was not mentioned in order. So putting these incidents in order is part of ijtihad. Scholars are doing their due diligence to put it in order to the best of their understanding and to the best of their ability. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Az-Zumar, that brother Jasir just recited, he said, وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَصَعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامُ يَنْظُرُونَ. So here in this verse, Allah is talking about Israfil blowing the horn twice. The first one, people will be shocked from the voice of the horn and from the Sunnah of Rasulullah. We knew that this will be repeated. Israfil will blow the horn again, so he will end the life on earth. So every one of us will die. You will die in your time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to live a certain amount of years, a limited time, for purpose to worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, to get to know Him, to know His guidance, to live according to His guidance, and to build our future after death. And this life will end. Every person will die in his time and the end of his life. And then there are people who will be alive when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders Israfil to blow the horn. So people will be shocked, and then Israfil will blow the horn again to end the life on earth. So every living being would be underground in the grave. And then while the people in their graves, you know, we have something in our back at the end of our backbone. It's called ajb al-dhanab. This is like a seed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when people are in their graves, will send the souls back to the bodies. After, the body will grow like a tree from ajb al-dhanab. Allah will send rain to the earth. So the body will be shaped in the grave again. And if after the body is shaped completely, the souls will be back in the body. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order the earthquake. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّ زَلْزَلَةَ السَّاعَةِ شَيْءٌ عَظِيمٌ. Allah عز وجل says in Surah Al-Hajj, O mankind, O people, have consciousness of your Lord. The earthquake of the hour is tremendous. The earthquake of the hour is a great thing. So this earthquake that will happen will break the graves. So people will be able to come out of their grave, all of them together. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be the first person to get out of his grave, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then all humanity will be out of their graves. All human beings, all nations, birds, animals, everybody back on the face of the earth. Completely naked. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was saying to the companions, يُحْشَرُ النَّاسُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ حُفَاءً عُرَى غُرْلًا. So حُفَاء, that means all of them are naked. عُرَى, without even shoe in the feet. حُفَاء, عُرَى. Then he said غُرْلًا, غُرْلًا, even without circumcision. Any piece of meat cut from you will be returned back to you. Aisha radiallahu anha, when she heard people will be resurrected from their graves naked, and men and women are looking to each other, so the Prophet said, alayhi salam, al-amru ashaddu min dhalik. That means people at that time will not be thinking about this stuff. In the day of judgment, people will be thinking about what's going to happen to them, the consequence of their deeds, their meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the final destination in Jannah and Hellfire. Nobody thinking about this stuff. Everybody is looking up. Everybody is waiting for what's going to happen to him. Something very important for the Muslims to remember and to put in mind, that Allah Azza wa Jalla promised the believers who will die as believers, who will die as Muslims, not to be afraid and not to grieve. Allah said subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. Allah said, indeed, those who are loyal to Allah, those who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who submitted their will to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. They will not grieve and they will not be afraid. So when you hear about these things, don't think that you will be afraid if you are a believer. If you are a believer, you will face these incidents with complete tranquility. You will feel happy that you are in the process to end in Jannah if you die as a believer with strong and complete iman. So people in this day, after they came out of their grave, you need to know that there are people who will be received with complete hospitality. They will be treated like VIP. They will find angels in the reception. The Prophet said that, alayhi salatu wasalam. Prophet Muhammad said, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, that there are people when they come out of their graves, they will find angels in the reception. VIP people, very important. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow the angels to take them on camels. So you may find a person riding a camel in the day of judgment. Or two people on one camel, or three people on one camel, taken to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Imagine somebody out of his grave and he's trying to find Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam walking on his feet, trying to find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by himself without any guide. What is the difference? The record. The one who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and cared about the deen and studied his Islam and was practicing his deen, not doing haram, even if he does haram, he repented immediately. The one who has a strong relationship with Allah azza wa jal. So this person will be treated in the Day of Judgment like VIP. If somebody doesn't have this strength in his deen, he's not that strong, he will be resurrected looking for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Day of Judgment, but he will be finding the Prophet on his own. And there are people, once they come out of their graves, will be arrested. Criminals. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, وَقِفُوهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ مَسْؤُولُونَ وَقِفُوهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ مَسْؤُولُونَ. Those people, once they get out of their graves, they find the angels are coming to lock them up, to arrest them, because they are considered wrongdoers. And then people will be given permission to be covered. And the first person will be covered in the Day of Judgment is Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam. And people will be waiting, standing for long. They don't know what will happen to them. They don't know what will happen. They will see changes. No sun, no moon. It's different earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced the earth. Everything on earth is different. They don't see any seas or oceans or mountains. It is a flat earth. White dust. And all human beings on the top of it, waiting for what's going to happen to them. So people will be looking for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because this is the appointment. The Prophet said alayhi wa sallam, and now it al-hawd. Our appointment with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Day of Judgment is beside Hawd al-Kawthar. So people will be very thirsty, looking for something to drink. So they will, once they arrive to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam beside the river of al-Kawthar, they will be given the permission to drink from the water of the river of al-Kawthar. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam beside the river, and the believers are arriving. Once they arrive, they drink from the river of al-Kawthar, and they will never feel thirsty after this. But some Muslims, once they come close to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam beside the river of al-Kawthar, they will be prevented and pushed back. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, Ummati, Ummati. In one of the ahadith, Usayhabi, Usayhabi, Ashabi, Ashabi, in many narrations, the Prophet will say, my companions, these people are believers, these people are Muslims. He's trying to intercede to keep them with him, alayhi wa sallam, but the angels will say to him, Ya Muhammad, innaka la tadri ma ahdathu ba'dak. O Muhammad, you don't know what they invented in the deen after you departed them. So the people of innovation, those who invented the deen and fabricate in the deen and falsify information in the deen and practice bid'ahs, will not be allowed to come close to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They will not be allowed to drink from the river of al-Kawthar, and Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, he will free himself from them, alayhi salatu wasalam. In dunya, the Prophet salam used to tell people, I will not be able to protect you in the Day of Judgment. Ask me what you need. He said this to Fatima. He said, Ya Fatima, bint Rasulullah, O Fatima, the daughter of the Messenger of Allah, salini ma shi'ti. Ask me whatever you need. فَإِنِّي لَا أُغْنِي عَنْكِ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْءٍ. I will not be able to protect you in the Day of Judgment. If you deserve the punishment, I can do nothing to you. He said to his aunt, Safiya, Ya Safiya, عَمَّةَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Oh Safiya, yes, you are the aunt of Rasulullah. You are the aunt of the Messenger of Allah. But I cannot do anything for you in the Day of Judgment. Without the permission of Allah, I cannot do anything for you. Without deserving my intercession, I cannot do anything for you. So the Prophet said to this ummah to follow his guidance, to follow his teaching, not to add anything to the deen, not to delete anything from the deen, not to replace anything from the teaching of Rasulullah. We should not mix the teaching of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم with our personal opinions. We should follow the deen purely as he taught us عليه الصلاة والسلام. And those who are following the guidance of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم as is, are the people who will be allowed to arrive to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in the day of judgment beside the river of Al-Kawthar and to drink from the river of Al-Kawthar. And their life in the day of judgment will be processed with him عليه الصلاة والسلام. So imagine yourself coming out of your grave, naked, terrorized, then you find the angels in your reception. Allahu Akbar. Imagine yourself, you are riding a camel in your way to meet with Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم with complete tranquility. Imagine yourself given the permission to cover yourself out of honor, to be honored by covering yourself, and to be under the shade of your righteous deeds. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم promised that the righteous people will be resurrected under the shade of his throne, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the day of judgment, people are standing on a flat earth and the sun is very close to them. The Prophet said, it would be 1 mile away. 1 mile away. Now see how the sun is too far and we are suffering the heat of the sun. In the day of judgment, the sun will be very close and people will suffer the heat of the sun when the sun is 1 mile away from them. And the Prophet said people will be swearing. People will be swearing. And their sweat, the sweat of some of them will cover up to the ankle. Their feet will be completely covered in their sweat. Some of them, their sweat will arrive to their knees. Some of them up to their waist, based on their deeds and their records. Subhanallah. People are honored, resurrected under the shade of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And among those people who are promised to be under the shade of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the youth. The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, وشاب نشأ في طاعة الله. One of the people who are promised by Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم to be resurrected under the shade of the throne of Allah سبحانه وتعالى, not to suffer the heat of the sun in the day of judgment, youth, somebody in young age, when he has desires and the power of his age, and he wants to do the haram, but he is holding himself back for the sake of Allah. And he's investing this power to learn his deen and to convey the message of Allah and to guide others and to share the khair with people. So this person is promised to be honored in front of the creation in the day of judgment and to be resurrected under the shade of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to be seen. Subhanallah, the creation will see that this person is under the shade of the throne of Allah Azzajal. He's not suffering the heat of the sun. That means he used to be a good person. A person who is allowed to cover himself, to be honored and cover himself. So this, the entire creation will see that this person is honored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So people after long time, you know, the day, the resurrection day, we call it a day, but it's 50,000 years. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that this day is 50,000 years. It doesn't mean that you will live the 50,000 year, because some people will leave from the day of judgment, and some of them will leave before others. Some people will leave early, and some people will stay up to the end. But the life in the day of judgment, it's 50,000 years. So people will be waiting, the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, for 70. For 70 years, people will be waiting for the judgment to start. And these will start talking to each other. أَلَا تَرَوْنَ مَا نَحْنُ فِيهِ. Don't you see what we are suffering from? Find somebody to intercede and ask Allah Azza wa Jal to start the judgment day. They are suffering without judgment yet. They are not judged yet. They did not confront their deeds. They are not confronted with their deeds yet. But they are suffering. Standing and waiting, they don't know what will happen. And then people will start to go to Adam عليه السلام. Prophet said عليه الصلاة والسلام in hadith called hadith al-shafa'ah. They will go to Adam عليه السلام and tell him, oh Adam, you are the father of humanity. You are our father. Allah Azza wa Jalla honored you and created you by his hands. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he commanded the angels to prostrate to you out of respect after he created the new creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted the new creation to be honored and greeted. So he commanded the angels to bow and prostrate to Adam to greet him and to show the new creature respect. So they would say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted your repentance. So ask him to start the judgment day, intercede for us. So Adam alayhi salam will say, Allah Azza wa Jal forbade me from eating from the tree and I disobeyed him. So I cannot speak today. I only care about myself. The father of humanity, Adam, the prophet of Allah, is afraid from what? From one sin. He committed only one sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him in Jannah, told him to live, enjoy, eat whatever he wants except one tree. And by the way, this tree is not the tree of knowledge, like what other ummas or other nations are claiming. No, it is a tree. If Adam ate from it, it will make changes in his body and he will not be able to stay in Jannah. He must be kicked out. Because in Jannah, nobody can spit, nobody can urinate or defecate. No. In Jannah, Jannah is a pure place, right? So Adam, at that time, he does not have a sexual desire. He doesn't have this and that. So once he ate from the tree, he is not fit to stay in Jannah anymore. So Adam alayhi salam was kicked out of Jannah, and because of this one sin, he is not able to stand in the day of judgment to intercede for his children, to intercede in behalf of that of the humanity. And here I want to highlight something to you. The sin of Adam was one. The sin of Hawa was one. And the sin of Iblis, the Shaytan, is one. When you read the story of Adam and the story of the creation, we all knew that Adam alayhi salam committed one sin only. One sin. And this one sin is causing him to be afraid in the day of judgment and not able to open his mouth or to face Allah Azza wa Jal because of one sin. Shaytan, the devil, he committed also one sin. This sin was when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him with the angels to greet Adam, he rejected out of arrogance. He was arguing with Allah Azza wa Jal, debating the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was claiming that he is better than Adam, so how he greets Adam and bow and prostrate to him. Adam alayhi salam, when he committed a sin, he accepted his guilt. He took complete responsibility of his mistake. And he did not blame anybody. He did not blame his wife. Right? Some people, when they narrate this story, they say his wife encouraged him to eat from the tree, right? But he never said to Allah Azza wa Jal, my wife encouraged me or whispered to me. She was the reason of this. And his wife Hawa did not say, oh Allah, he is the man in charge. He is the husband. So when he did it, I did it like him. And both of them did not say, Iblis was the reason, he is a shaitan. He whispered to us, he inspired us to do this. No, complete responsibility. Complete responsibility of their mistake. They believe Allah is their Lord. Allah is the one who has the most beautiful names and attributes. Allah is the one who has right to legislate, has right to command, to order. And once he commanded them to do something, they must do it. And out of weakness, they followed their desires and disobeyed Allah Azza wa Jal, and immediately they owned their mistake. They did not blame others. And they said, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Oh Allah, we wronged ourselves. Nobody to blame except us. We wronged ourselves. And if you do not forgive us, we will be among the losers in the day of judgment. Look to Iblis. When he committed the sin, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, as you read in the Quran, مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيَّ. What prevented you from prostrating to what I have created by my hand? Right? He said, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْهُ, I'm better than him. So he is objecting and he is arguing and debating Allah regarding his command. Rejecting the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. and he never took responsibility, complete responsibility of his mistake, of his crime. He never owned his mistake. He will blame Allah Azza wa Jalla. He will not blame himself. This is the difference between a believer who commits a sin and a disbeliever. The disbeliever will always argue with the command of Allah. He will argue with Allah. He will reject the legislation. But the believer, when he commits a sin, he owns his mistake immediately. He shows humbleness. And he will ask Allah to forgive him. And he will not blame anyone else. So we all human beings and we all do mistakes. But once we do mistake, we must own our mistake. For instance, if somebody, his friend invited him to something wrong, something haram, alcohol, drugs, whatever, and he did it. Once you do that, you need to own your mistake. Don't come to argue, khamr is not haram, drugs is not haram. Some people like to argue, right? No, it is haram, but it's not a big deal. It is haram, but my friend caused me to do it, so he is responsible, not me. Once you do that, no forgiveness for you. Forgiveness comes with humbleness. Same thing with a sister. If a sister is not able to wear hijab yet, she should not argue with Allah and say hijab is not mandatory, hijab is not fard. No, we should not say that. We say hijab is fard, that this is the command of Allah, fard by consensus, right? All scholars, all madahib are saying hijab is fard. So what should we do? We say, oh Allah, forgive us and make us able to do it, but not to argue. If a sister is saying, I'm not convinced, you are not convinced, convinced of what? You are not convinced that Allah has right to legislate? You are not convinced that the legislation of Allah is good for you and for your guidance in dunya and akhirah? You are not convinced it is a righteous action? You are not convinced that it is in the Quran? You are not convinced that it is in the sunnah? You need to tell us, well, you are not convinced of what? It is better to say, I'm a weak person, I'm trying to be better, and inshallah, I'm working on myself to do it. And to humble ourselves and to accept what Allah did legislate, and to believe in every piece of legislation in the Quran and the Sunnah, and to hope always to be better and to work with ourselves until we complete our iman before we meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when the creation will go to Adam alayhi salam, he will say sorry for them. I cannot help you. He is our father, but he cannot help us in the day of judgment. So the creation will go to the second man, the second father of humanity. By the way, we are the children of Adam and we are the children of Nuh. Because Nuh is the second father of humanity. Right? So Nuh in the lineage of each one of us. He's between us and Adam. Right? For sure. So the people will go to Nuh alayhi salam to repeat what they said to Adam. To say to him, Nuh, you are the messenger of Allah. You are the messenger of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted you and accepted da'wah. So intercede for us, don't you see what we are suffering from? So Nuh alayhi salam will say to them, no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted me and accepted da'wah, so I use the part of it against my ummah. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala offered him and accepted da'wah, at the end of his mission, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it is mentioned in the end of Surah Nuh, he said, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِمَنْ دَخَلَ بَيْتِيَ مُؤْمِنًا وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَلَا تَزِدَ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا تَبَارًا. So he used the half of the da'wah for himself. He said, oh Allah, forgive me and my parents, and every believer enters my house, and every believing man and every believing woman. So he asked Allah to forgive him and the believers and his parents, and he made dua against those who disbelieved in him, the kuffar, those who rejected his prophecy. So he said, since I used my power to retaliate against those who did not believe in me, I will not be able to speak in the day of judgment. Go to other person. I cannot intercede for you. So people will go after that to Ibrahim alayhi salam, and they will say to Ibrahim alayhi salam, you are the father of the prophets. Intercede for us, don't you see what we are suffering from? So Ibrahim alayhi salam will say to them that he lied in his lifetime 3 times. Do you think that Prophet Ibrahim lied? He's calling himself lying, but he never lied. He used something we call it in Islam, al-ma'arid. Al-ma'arid is to say something and to mean something else, right? For instance, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was migrated from Mecca to Medina with Abu Bakr, somebody stopped him. And this person recognized Abu Bakr, but he did not recognize the Prophet. Alayhi wasallam, Prophet was covering his face, was not recognized. So this man who stopped him, he asked Abu Bakr, who is this person? So Abu Bakr said, Hadi yahdini tariq. He is a guide guiding me in my way, in my trip. People, the Arab in the past, when they travel in the desert, they used to rent a guide. This guide will tell them where is the north, where is the south, east, west, how to survive these mountains. So human navigator, right? Human GPS. So in this moment, Abu Bakr Siddiq said, هُوَ هَادِي يَهْدِينِ الطَّرِيقِ. He is a guide guiding me in my way. He is not fine. Yes, the Prophet was not working for him. He's not paying the Prophet to show him. The Prophet himself doesn't know the way from Mecca to Medina, right? From this direction that he took at that time. But he meant he is guiding him in my way to Allah. So his statement is not fully lying, right? He said something truthful and he meant something and he caused the other person to understand something else. In the time of war, the Prophet also was asked by somebody who did not recognize him, where are you from? He said, from man. From man. So the man who asked him understood, he's from a tribe, its name is man. But the Prophet meant, from man, it means from the man of the man. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created every one of us from the man of his father and the egg of his mother, right? So he said something truthful and he made the other person to understand something else. And this is what Ibrahim did, and it's very important to me to make sure that you will not misunderstand that the prophets do not do mistakes. They don't do haram. What Ibrahim called himself doing a lie, it's not really a lie, right? Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he destroyed the idols and he kept one of them, then the people, the idol worshippers, when they came to ask him, who destroyed the idols? He said, the big one of them. The biggest one of them destroyed the rest. So they said, you know, it's idol doesn't destroy. This statue will never destroy the rest of the statues. It doesn't benefit, it doesn't harm. So he's just trying to, in this debate, to make a point. So if it doesn't benefit and doesn't harm, how we worship a rock that doesn't benefit and doesn't harm? Right? But he was not lying. But when he was asking about his wife Sarah, he said, she's my sister. He meant my sister in the deen. But she was not his sister from his mother. She's his wife. But he said this to protect her, because if he said she's my wife, they will kill him and kidnap her, right? But if he said she's my sister, he may ask for her hand. So he has time to solve the problem with them. These are soldiers of the Namrud. So because of this, Ibrahim alayhi salam in the Day of Judgment is saying, I cannot speak. I cannot intercede. I cannot stand up before Allah to intercede in behalf of others. So I want you to reflect on that and to think of us. How many sins you are committing? If Adam, just because of one violation, is not able to speak in the Day of Judgment, he ate from a tree. And he already paid the price, but he was kicked out of Jannah. Right? And repented, and his repentance is accepted, and he's still not able to speak. Because of a da'wah, Nuh alayhi salam made it against those who disbelieved in him, those who opposed him, those who are against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and against his book, against his messenger, against his guidance, and he's considering this wrongly because it was better than that to make du'a for him. Right? Subhanallah, Ibrahim alayhi salam, because of al-ma'arid, which is permissible, he is considered himself doing something prevents him from speaking in behalf of humanity in the Day of Judgment. Then they will go to Musa alayhi salam. They will say to Musa alayhi salam, you are the messenger of Allah. He gave you the Torah, he wrote the Torah for you. So intercede for us. So Musa alayhi salam will say, I killed a person in the day during my life. So I cannot intercede in your behalf. I cannot speak in behalf of humanity today. All of us knew that Musa is not a killer, and he did not kill any person. He was, it was a fight between two people, and he's trying to push them away from each other, but because he was a very strong person, when he pushed it on, who's resisting him strongly, this man accidentally, his head was hit in a rock, and he died accidentally. And because of that, he said, I'm not able to speak in the desert. He's not qualified for that. Go to somebody else. And then the hadith is saying that humanity will go to Isa alayhi salam. And they will ask Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, to speak in behalf of humanity with Allah and to ask Allah to start the judgment day. So Isa alayhi salam will not mention any violation he did. We all knew that Allah Azza wa Jalla elevated Isa alayhi salam to heaven during his lifetime. He did not commit any sin, and he did not mention any sin. And he would say, go to Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam. Go to Muhammad. If you want to get to the end of this, you need somebody to intercede for you. The one who is promised to intercede is Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam. Go to Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbihi wa ma ta'akhkhar. So go to Muhammad. Allah Azza wa Jalla forgave his past and his future, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the humanity will go to Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, and they will say to him, you promised to intercede. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam will say, ana laha, I'm for it. He will say, I am for it. I will do it, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Then after he accepts, he will go to prostrate under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask Allah azza wa jal to start the judgment. So Allah Azza wa Jal will tell Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to raise his head from this prostration and to ask whatever he wants. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will ask that the day of judgment to start. So his intercession will be accepted, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start the day of judgment. So this intercession of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the first intercession in the day of judgment, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will make many intercessions in the day of judgment. The first one of them will benefit the entire humanity, because when Allah starts the judgment day, all humanity will be benefited from that, because all of them wants to know what's going to happen to them. All of them wants the process to start. So after that, it will be العرض على الله سبحانه وتعالى. What is العرض? العرض, it means the nations will be standing in rows. Every nation behind their prophet. So we have Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he has the rows of the believers behind him. Have you ever seen assembly in school? How these every class stand by themselves, right? Behind the teacher. So you have Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the companions behind him, the followers of the companions, the followers of the followers, and then the ummah, all the true believers and the hypocrites with them. So we have people used to say they are Muslims in dunya, but in fact they are not Muslims. They are Muslims from outside, but not Muslims from inside. So these people, to this moment in the day of judgment, they are mixed with the Muslims, standing behind the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, not exposed yet. Subhanallah. And then Musa alayhi salam will have the believers who believed in him behind him. Isa alayhi salam will have those who believed in him behind him. And every prophet like Ibrahim, Nuh alayhi salam, the rest of the prophets and the messengers of Allah. And by the way, the prophets of Allah, 124,000 prophets Allah sent to dunya. Remember this number. 124,000 prophets from Adam until Muhammad alayhi salam. 124,000 prophets and 315 messengers. So the 315 messengers will be standing, and behind every messenger, the true believers who believed in him. You are the true believer of Isa alayhi salam if you believed in Isa alayhi salam as a prophet and messenger. And if you believed in Isa alayhi salam in his time, because every prophet has time. And once his time expires, you cannot follow him. Right? The time of Musa was expired when Isa was sent. So if you are living one of the followers of Musa and living in the time of Isa, you must follow Isa alayhi salam. If you believed in Jesus Christ in his time as a messenger of prophet, if you believed in that authentic copy of the gospel, and then you catch it Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you must believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He became from his ummah. So all true believers will be standing behind the prophet, and those who used to believe in false gods will be stand behind their false gods. Imagine somebody was worshiping rat, standing in the day of judgment behind a rat. Wallahi, I used to hear this. You are laughing. I used to hear this and never believed in it. People told me, we have in India, people worship rats. So I didn't believe it. I thought they are joking with me because it doesn't make sense. So somebody brought a videotape to me and I saw Allah al-Azim, they built huge castle, house of worship, to worship rats. They spent tons of dollars to build the big houses to worship rats. And people very luxurious. You see somebody's driving a very luxury car, looks educated, come into the parking lot, enter in this house of worship, and he's so happy that a rat crossed on his foot. Wallahi al-Azim, once a rat ran on his foot, he is blessed. The rat is, as I saw in the video, the rat is afraid from them. When they enter the room, the rat is running from them. And they are worshiping the rat. Wallahi al-Azim, fact. Some people are worshiping cows, and I'm sure you saw that in videos. Somebody, they put his body on the floor for the cow to walk on his body, right? Or, subhanAllah, people will be behind what they worship in dunya. In this arda ala Allah Azza wa Jal. Nations are standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make al-hisab. So what is al-hisab? Here there are discussions among the scholars if the people who receive the book first, or they will be judged first and then receive the book. We don't need to discuss the order. It's not important. But I want you to know, if somebody passed away and died as a disbeliever, he will end in hellfire without any discussion. He will be taken to hellfire directly. If Ummah worshipped other than the Creator, because it is not fair that Allah creates and the creation worship, the creation's worship other than Allah. It's not fair that Allah sustains and provides and the creations thank and appreciate other than Allah. Allah is the only worthy of being worshipped. He created heavens, earth, sun, moon, hellfire, paradise, human being, jinn kind, angels, animals, birds, fishes, all these creations. He created all the universe to be worshipped, to be obeyed. So if people will be created by Allah and worship other than Him, Allah sustains them and they thank other than Him, so they are wrongdoers and they are oppressors and they deserve the consequence of their actions. Especially that Allah sent, as I said to you, 315 messengers with books to teach them. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala sent 124,000 prophets for their guidance, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He gifted them brains to figure right from wrong, and to reflect and to think. And they used all these stuff to enjoy this limited life, ignoring the unlimited life that they are about to enter. So these people deserve what will happen to them. They will be sent to hellfire directly. Now when we talk about the believers a little bit, we have the believers different types. Because not all of us are one level, right? We have Prophet Muhammad the highest level. Then we have somebody like Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. If you put Abu Bakr by himself in a pan of a scale and you put the rest of the Ummah of Islam in the other pan, he is heavier than them. Subhanallah, by his iman, the strength of his iman, his commitment, his truthfulness, his sincerity. So his deeds, right? So no one is better than Abu Bakr after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and no one is better than Umar after Abu Bakr. And if Allah will send the prophets after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr and Umar have the qualities of prophet. The Prophet said alayhi wasallam that if Allah will make a prophet after me, this prophet will be Umar. But Allah will not make, because Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the sealed nectar of prophecy alayhi wasallam. So what I'm saying here, that people will be facing the record of their deeds. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam here said that there are people will be allowed to enter Jannah without any discussion. Pay attention to this, it's very important. There are people will be allowed to enter Jannah without any discussion. They will not be asked anything, no interrogation. We cannot interrogate somebody if he did not commit a crime, right? If somebody did never committed a crime, or he committed crime and repented from it, so why you interrogate him for? You expect you bring a prosecutor to interrogate him? So if somebody, he left this dunya doing good deeds, and the bad deed that he did, he repented from. So he will not be questioned. And this is the second intercession of the Prophet ﷺ in the Day of Judgment. The first intercession is to start the judgment today. This intercession will benefit the entire humanity. And this intercession is al-maqam al-mahmood that we ask Allah when we hear the adhan. You know, when you say, Allahumma rabba hadhihi da'wat al-tamma wa salat al-ta'ima ati muhammadan al-wasilat al-fadila wa ba'athu Allahumma maqaman mahmoodan alladhi wa'adda. So this is al-maqam al-mahmood. The stand that Prophet Muhammad will have in the Day of Judgment, the position that he will have in the Day of Judgment, that all creation will praise him for, subhanAllah, for the beginning of the Judgment Day. But the second intercession the Prophet will make, to take the people who have no record at all to Jannah without any accountability, no questioning, no interrogation whatsoever, Allah Azza wa Jalla, Prophet Muhammad will prostrate and ask him to intercede again. Allah Azza wa Jalla accepted the second intercession and tell him, يعني أدخل من لا حساب عليه من أمتك من باب الجنة الأيمن. So there is a door in the right side of the Jannah. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم will take the Muslims or the believers who did not have any sins to be questioned about, because whether they did not commit the sin or they committed the sin and repented from it. So then they will be taken to the Jannah directly with Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. He will be the first person to knock the door of Jannah. The first person, the door of Jannah will be opened to, and he will allow these believers to enter Jannah. We have other category of believers who committed mistakes and repented from it in dunya. But Allah will bring him. Allah will bring them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he will, the hadith said, فَأَضَعُ كَنَفَهُ عَلَيْهِ, which means Allah will cover the conversation from the creation. This conversation will be one-on-one with Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah Almighty will let the person read his mistakes. عَبْدِي أَتَذْكُرُ ذَنْبَكَلَى. My servant, do you remember this sin that you committed in this day and this time? Do you remember this? So the servant will say, أَذْكُرْ يَا رَبْ, أَذْكُرْ يَا, I remember, my Lord, I remember. So Allah will say, عَبْدِي أَتَذْكُرُ ذَنْبَكَلَى. Do you see this sin that you committed in this day and this time? He will say, أَذْكُرْ يَا رَبْ, أَذْكُرْ يَا رَبْ. The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, هذا في الصغائر والعبد من الكبائر مشفق. يعني he is confronted with his minor sins, and he did not see the major sins yet. So he is worried. What will happen when Allah shows the major ones? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell him, ها أنا قد سترتها عليك في الدنيا وها أنا أغفرها لك الآن. ها أنا قد سترتها عليك في الدنيا. يعني I covered you when you did it in dunya. A lot of us, we do mistakes while people are not seeing us, right? We hide from people. So now Allah will tell you, I was seeing you. You did not include me. When you made your decision to hide, you did not hide from me. He was hiding from creation, but not from me. So Allah said, I covered you in dunya, and I will forgive you today. Enter the Jannah. Subhanallah. So this person, the one who achieved the forgiveness of Allah, he committed the sin and repented, and Allah forgave him. So what is the difference between al-afwa and al-maghfira? We have word afu and we have word maghfira. We ask Allah to forgive us, right? And Ramadan is coming, and you will remember that Aisha asked the Prophet ﷺ and said, O Messenger of Allah, if I know this is the night of Laylatul Qadr, what they say? The Prophet said to Aisha to say in her supplication, Allahumma innaka afu, tuhibbu al-af, fa'afu anni. So ask Allah to pardon you. So what's the difference between forgiveness and pardoning? The difference, forgiveness is with confrontation. Allah will bring you and show you your deed in your book. Read yourself. اقرأ كتابك كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا. Read your book yourself. This is what you did. Then after you feel bad and you are embarrassed in front of Allah Azza wa Jal, worried about the entire record, Allah will tell you, you repented, I forgave you. I'm not going to let the creation know about this. I covered you in dunya, I forgive you today. But the pardoning is different, something different. It appeared in hadith that one of the people, when he is confronted with his deeds, he will show the minor sins, and he will admit to his guilt and say, oh Allah, I did this, oh Allah, I did this. I'm not denying what I did. And he's worried about his major sins. Then Allah will say he covered him in dunya, and he will forgive him in akhirah, and he will order the angels to replace his bad deeds with good deeds. To replace his bad deeds to be good deeds. So the servant will say, Ya Rab, inna li a'malan la araha ha'huna. He will say, oh Allah, there are deeds I made, I'm not seeing it in my book. So there, when he saw that Allah is replacing the bad deeds with good deeds, he is telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are deeds I did in my lifetime, but I'm not seeing it in my book. Why? Because if Allah pardoned you, you're not going to find it in the book. So if you ask Allah Azza wa Jal to pardon you, and He accepts, that means even in the Day of Judgment, He will not embarrass you, and He will not ask you about it or confront you with it. So this is higher level, higher than forgiveness, to be pardoned with Allah. May Allah pardon all of us. Allahumma ameen. Then, there are people who committed major sins. As Muslims from Ahl Sunnah, we believe that if somebody is committing a major sin and he did not repent from it, if he repented from it, we are sure that Allah will never break His promise. Allah will accept the repentance and He forgives. In the Day of Judgment, you have no promise. If you came in the Day of Judgment as Muslim with major sins that you did not repent from, or if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put your bad deeds and good deeds, and your bad deeds are more than your good deed, you deserve the punishment of hell, but it is up to Allah. You don't know, maybe Allah will forgive you for something that you never expect. But there is a chance for Allah's forgiveness, even without repentance and the Day of Judgment, but it's not guaranteed because there is no promise. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you see, there are people who deserve to be punished, and people who deserve to be punished, Allah will forgive them. People who deserve to be punished, Allah will punish them based on the justice of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah is fair. And He will treat His creation with complete fairness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you have the tayur suhuf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the books, and every believer will have his book with his right hand. And every disbeliever or wrongdoer who deserves to be punished in hellfire, even if he's Muslim, he will receive the book with his left hand behind his back. فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا وَيَنْقَلِبُ إِلَى أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ وَرَاءَ ظَهْرِهِ فَسَوْفَ يَدْعُو ثُبُورًا وَيَصْلَى سَعِيرًا. So if a person received the book by their right hand, that means he will take the book as it is mentioned in Surah Al-Haqqah. You know somebody, a player, soccer player, when he scores goal, how do you do? What do you do? They run, right, in the stadium, in front of the fans, right? Happy? Same thing. And when the believer receives the book by his right hand, and see that Allah accepted his good deeds and the bad deeds are forgiven, he will take the book, he will show off. He's not going to be hiding. He will show off, he will take the book and run in the day of judgment, try to show the believers that I'm accepted, I'm forgiven. Allah said in the Quran, وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابُ يَمِينِهِ. And the one who will receive the book by his right hand, فَيَقُولْ هَاؤُمُ اقْرَأُوا كِتَابِيَهِ. He will say to people, read my book, read my book. إِنِّي ظَنَنْتُ أَنِّي مُلَاقٍ حِسَابِيَهِ. I was expecting to be punished. يعني when he was standing in the day of judgment, he thought that it will end bad. And he will end in hellfire. But alhamdulillah, Allah's mercy reached him. He will say, إِنِّي ظَنَنْتُ أَنِّي مُلَاقٍ حِسَابِيَهِ. He said, فَهُوَ فِي عِيشَةٍ رَاضِيَةٍ فِي جَنَّةٍ عَالِيَةٍ. The end of the verses. Allah said, he will end in the high Jannah. Will be completely pleased in the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you can read the rest of the verses in the surah. And then, وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِشِمَالِهِ. In one verse, in one surah, Allah said, there are people who be receiving the books with their left hand. In another surah, he said, behind the back. Why behind the back? He doesn't want somebody to see. He has bad things. And usually when you have bad things, we don't want somebody to know, right? Now if you put the names of those who passed the test in this university or in this college at the door, if you go and see yourself passing with good grade, you will highlight your name with yellow highlighters. Not everybody to pay attention. But if you see failing grade, what are you going to do? Scratch it, right? You take it off. You don't try to see it. Same thing in the deep judgment. The one who has a good record will be raising his hand, raising his book, screaming, running, telling people, read my book, I'm successful. But the losers will hide the book behind their back. اقرأ كتابك كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيب. Allah will say, read your book by yourself. And this is, by the way, if we need to study the day of judgment, we need a complete semester. It needs episodes. I'm cutting many things, trying to make it brief and short. But there is a process how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will confront people with their deeds. And some people will even deny what they did. They will say, oh, no, I didn't do this. No, oh Allah, I didn't do this. No, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command the body parts to speak. If somebody stole by his hand will say, no, I stole. I did it. If he bit somebody by tongue and he's denying, his tongue will speak and say, I did back with this person. And that's why it is mentioned in the hadith, the person will say to his body parts, تَبَّنْ لَكُنَّ وَصُحْقَى فَعَنْ كُنَّ كُنْتُ مُجَهْدِلْ. He will make dua against his own body parts because he was trying to argue on their behalf. He was lying to protect the body parts. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make the person to testify against himself. Subhanallah. The sin that you committed by body part, this body part, will testify against you. And when you hear about this stuff, don't say it doesn't make sense. Right? Because anything related to the day of judgment is part of the unseen. We cannot imagine it the way it is. Because you have a limited ability. Your brain is limited. Your sight is limited. Your voice is limited. Your ability to hear is limited. Right? So if there is voice you cannot hear because it's too low. And there is voice you cannot hear because it's too strong. You are not hearing the angels when they are talking. Their voice is too strong for your ear to hear it. Right? Same thing. You have a limited voice. If you are not able to reach all people with your voice, use microphone. Right? Same thing, your brain, when you speak about the attributes of Allah, you will not be able to imagine Allah. Because Allah beyond your imagination. The scholars used to teach us this statement. When you read about the attributes of Allah, they say, كُلُّ مَا خَطَرَ بِبَالِكَ فَاللَّهُ بِخِلَافِ ذَلِكَ. يعني, when you read about the attributes of Allah, any picture comes to your mind, Allah is different. Because Allah لا يحاط به علما. He's greater than your ability. But in the Quran, we will see Allah in the day of judgment. It's a gift from Allah to something else. The power that people will be given in Jannah to see Allah, it's a gift. But this limited power will not allow you to know everything related to the unseen the way it is. When you know there is a life in the grave, people sometimes argue, how people live in the grave? I put the body, if I came 5 days later, I will see a body, there is no life, there is no soul. Yeah, you will never figure. It's something concealed from you. You will not know about it until you die. But in the grave you live. In your bed sometimes you are alive. When you sleep, you see a dream. You see yourself in different continent, dancing or singing, right? Some people may see themselves in car accident. In a dream. Your life in the grave is completely something else. Something that you will know in your life. Before that, no way to figure it, how it is. It's different habit. In the day of judgment also, when you hear that your hand will speak and your tongue will speak, sometimes people reject that. So how you are speaking now? How you are able to see now, right? You will see verses in the Quran that there are arrogant people who will be resurrected in the size of an ant in the day of judgment. They used to feel themselves very big guys, great, better than people. Allah will make them resurrected like an ant, about to be stepped on in the day of judgment, because of, as a consequence of their arrogance. There are people who will walk on their face. Imagine somebody, his lips, a nose, an eyelid, an eyebrows. This will be his legs, to walk on his face. How come? People told the Prophet, how come, by the way? When the Prophet was reciting this to them, the people asked him, how come people walk on their face? He said, Allah, who is able to make them walk on their feet, will make them walk on their face. Allah, who created us in the first time, will be able to create us in the resurrection day again. And the one who made us to walk on our feet in dunya, he will make some of us walk on their face in akhirah as a type of humiliation for those who deserve to be humiliated. Those who are oppressors and wrongdoers, criminals. Criminals according to the law of Allah, not criminals according to human laws. According to the laws of Allah, whoever is criminal, he will be humiliated and punished in the day of judgment. So after people are confronted with their deeds and receiving their books, Allah will put the scale, al-mizan. So we believe in al-ard, al-hashr, al-ard, al-hisab, all this stuff are the pillars of our belief in the day of judgment. So we believe also in the scale. And the scholars have to have a discussion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put what in the scale? He will put every human being? Or he will put the book of the human being? Or the deeds of a human being will be put in a certain way in a pan? We don't know that. We don't know the details of that. If it is, what will be put on the scale? Most likely the book. And the book will be heavy according to the amount of good deeds that is written in the book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hired the angels to write good deeds and angels to write bad deeds. He subhanahu wa ta'ala described those angels by saying, each one of them is raqib atid. That is, watching you, is not missing any of your actions or words, and is capable of doing his mission. And these books, when you die, when the soul is taken from the body, the angels will take the soul and the books and return the books above seven heaven. Whether in Iliyin or Sajjin. Iliyin is the library of the people of Jannah, of Paradise. The book will be put in this Iliyin. If somebody will be in the hellfire in the day of judgment, his book will be put in Sajjin. And this also mentioned in the Quran. And in the day of judgment, these books will be given to the person. If he received the book by his right hand, the book was in Aliyin and in the Jannah. If he received the book with his left hand behind his back, that means the book was in Sijjin and he will end in hellfire. So Allah will put the book and weigh the deeds. So the one who has good deeds more than bad deeds, he will enter Jannah. Because Allah made the rule, إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتِ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ. A companion committed a sin and came to Prophet Muhammad ﷺ and said, O Messenger of Allah, I committed a sin. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ did not answer him because the Prophet ﷺ never spoke without revelation. Until Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed it to him, this verse, أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ رَفَيْنِ النَّهَارِ وَسُلَفًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتِ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ. So Allah revealed it to Prophet Muhammad ﷺ to tell this person to pray in the beginning of the daytime, in the end of the daytime, to make a lot of prayers, saying إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتُ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ. That means his good deeds will take away his bad deeds, will erase the bad deeds. So the man said, is it for me alone, O Messenger of Allah? Is this revelation only for me? The Prophet said, no, this is for my ummah. So all hasanat, there is all sayyat. Same size, same weight. So if your good deed in a pan, your bad deeds in a pan, if the good deeds are more, so this person guaranteed Jannah. If the bad deeds are more than the good deeds, so we say this person under the will of Allah. Allah will judge. So he will wait for his sentence. We don't know how in the court of Allah the sentence will be. Maybe he will be forgiven. Maybe he will be serving time in the prison of hell. We don't know. This is by Allah Azza wa Jalla. Then if we remove from this, that people will be losing light in the day of judgment. It will become completely dark. So after that, people will see darkness. You cannot see anything around you. You cannot see any other human being. Then every person will be given a light according to his record of righteousness, until his record of good deed. See, your good deed will benefit you where? Now your good deed is still serving you in the grave. The light in your grave, the whiteness of the grave based on your record. How you'll be resurrected based on your record. If you have a big, good record of good deeds, you'll be safe, not afraid, you'll never grieve. You'll have tranquility, you'll be treated well by the angels of Allah. You'll drink from the river of Al-Kawthar. All your steps will be good. And when Allah takes the light and turns everything to be dark, He will start to distribute light and gives every person a light based on his record. That means people will have a very strong light and people will be given light less than them. Right? And some people, they don't have enough light to see the way, so they will use the light of others. They walk beside others to see by their light. Even the hypocrites will be given light. Still, hypocrites and are given light, yes. Allah will give them light until they walk toward something called the Sirat. What is the Sirat? The Sirat is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command the angels to bring the hellfire. Hellfire will appear and people will see after the hellfire the paradise. There is Sirat, then mountain of Al-A'raf, then Al-Qantara, then paradise. That will be seen but too far. And for you have no way to go except toward hellfire, all human being. Allah said, وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا كَانَ عَلَى رَبِّكَ حَتَّى مَقْضِيًّا. يعني every single human being will go to the hellfire and will see it and cross it. Above the hellfire, do you see the river? Hudson River, for instance, when you see bridge above this the river and you cross by your car, it is the hellfire under human being, and there is no bridge. There will be a sirat. The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, أدق من الشعرة وأحد من السيف. It is thinner than a hair, piece of hair, and sharper than edge of a sword. How dangerous it is. And then there is no way to see except by the light that Allah gave you based on your record. All ummah will be directed to the Sirat. Ummah of Muhammad is the first ummah. Prophet Muhammad said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, نحن الآخرون الأولون. We are the last nation on earth. We are the followers of final Prophet and Messenger. And we are the first nation to cross hellfire. And the first person who will cross hellfire from our ummah is Prophet Muhammad, عليه الصلاة والسلام. But to make long story short, people will be crossing hellfire in different categories. First category, Prophet Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام himself. Second category, people will be crossing hellfire like Okay? So they cross very quickly. The time that you need to close your eye and open it, these people will be in the other side. So nothing will happen to them. They will not feel the heat. Nothing from their body will be burned. Safe. Then, second category, people will pass like a speedy wind. You know, speedy wind, when it's hot, you feel the warmness, right? It's warm. Because under you, there is hellfire. And you are in the speed of a speedy wind. Then the Prophet said, other category of Muslims will cross as if they are riding horses. They are not riding horses. He's talking about the speed. He's trying to make us understand the different speed. So the category of people will be passing above a sirat with a speed of a horse, the speed of a horse that will feel more warm, right? Because wind is faster than horse. Then there are people will be running on their feet. Now it's becoming difficult, right? Because under you is hellfire. So why I'm feeling that? Because of fikr. Your good deeds are not taking you. You don't have enough gas, right? And there is a car, 4-cylinder, a car, 8-cylinder, right? And there is a flight, different speed. If you want to be speedy, if you want to have enough light, make the night prayer. Read the Quran. Help the needy. You have a lot of good deeds to do. All this will make light, will give you speed, will make you stronger, will make you more comfortable and more enjoying the tranquility in the day of judgment. If you have less, that means less deeds, more suffering. So people will be crossing, but by running in the speed of human being. This is tough medicine. Because once you are on your feet and running, that means you will feel the heat more. All that, not inside the fire. You are still not inside the fire. Nobody until now inside this fire. But they are feeling the heat. And then after that, you will be walking. And people will be on a sirat, on their hands and knees. Imagine somebody above the sirat, he's looking down, he sees hellfire. Do you see yourself when you are in the flight? And you look down, you see the city too far. So you are on the sirat. And when you look down, you see the hellfire there. And you are not able to sleep, and you are on your knees. Until you cross hellfire from the beginning to the end. You will go, mashallah, sotay. May Allah protect all of us. But you need to understand it this way. I'm not joking, I'm just trying to tell you. This is not going to be a complete surviving, because now you started to feel a sort of punishment. And there are people, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will be lashed above his sirat by something. He said, like Shawk al-Sa'dan, he was telling the companions, there are khatatif in the right and the left of the sirat. These khatatif, people ask the Prophet, what's khatatif? He said, myth the Shawk al-Sa'dan, يعني it's like a tree that has leaves. Do you see these sticks that people can take from a tree and hit with it? So it will be something like that, looks like that. And there are people who will be sentenced to get lashes while they are trying to cross the sirat. Why they get lashes? Because of bad deeds. This is their punishment. Without entering hellfire, right? On a sirat. So now we have people are passing like the lightning, like al barq. People like going by, or a speed of wind, or a speed of a horse, or running on the feet, or walking, or on the knees and the hands. And there are people who will be beaten up. On the sirat, this is their punishment. And they will survive. So Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, فَنَاجٍ مُسَلَّمٍ. Somebody will be surviving completely. وَمَخْدُوشٌ نَاجٍ. يعني some people will be getting some lashes and they will survive also. He said, وَمَخْدُوشٌ فِي النَّارِ. And some people, their light will be turned off. The hypocrites. So this is the first time the hypocrites will lose the light. Those who used to deceive the Muslims in dunya and to deceive Allah. Allah said, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهُ وَخَادِعُونَ. The hypocrites are trying to deceive Allah, and Allah will return their deception upon them. So those who are trying to deceive Allah in dunya, to deceive the believers, will be deceived in akhirah. How they will be deceived? They will be allowed to stand behind the Prophet in the time of al-'Ard. And they will receive the book like the believers. And they will be given some light until now they think they are surviving. And after they think they are surviving, above the sirat, Allah will take away the light from them and send them to hellfire. And everyone was sentenced to serve time in hellfire will be dropped from Sirat. May Allah protect all Muslims from that. And then after people survive Sirat and go to the other side, there is people will be standing above the mountain of Al-A'raf. The mountain, you know, there is a chapter of Al-A'raf. In the Quran, a chapter, Surah Al-A'raf. Allah mentioned that mountain of Al-A'raf in this Surah. And there are people, their hasanat and their sayyat are equal. So their punishment after they survive the Surah to stand above Al-A'raf. So when you are standing above Al-A'raf at that time, you do not know what will happen to you. So you are worried. This is your punishment. The worry that you will have at that time. And at the same time, you will be suffering sorrow that you didn't do better in dunya. And every time you look to the hellfire and see what's going on there, you will be afraid. And every time you see Jannah and what's going on in it, you will hope. Okay? So this is your punishment. You will be in this condition, you serve your time on the mountain of Al-A'raf, and then the people of Al-A'raf will be released in Jannah. Will be released to Jannah. And subhanAllah, there is a bridge. In this bridge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will gather the people who have rights upon each other. Somebody Muslim stole the money of another Muslim. Muslim, Muslima, backbit another Muslim. Or created rumor about another Muslim. So now Allah will bring them there to pay each other. They need to pay each other. So Allah will fulfill the right of every believer from his Muslim brother on this bridge. Then the people will be entering Al-Jannah after that. We all knew that the first thing, Allah will ask us from our deeds, Allah will ask us about from our deeds, is As-Salah. As it is in the hadith of Bunya al-Islam ala khams. If you died upon Tawheed, fallen Prophet Muhammad sallam, you'll be resurrected as a believer, and the first question is about Salah. And the Prophet said, alayhi wasalam, if your salah is valid and accepted, Allah will look to the rest of the deeds. But if your salah is not valid and accepted, Allah will not review the rest of the deeds. So to know the importance of salah. Salah is a condition for the rest of your deeds to be accepted. So your tawheed, la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, your iman, your faith, and the six articles of faith, and the salah, these are the condition for Allah to review the risk of the deeds. So أول ما يحاسب عليه العبد من عمله الصلاة. The first thing Allah will ask about in the day of judgment for his rights after Tawheed is salah. Then is zakat, then is siyam, and so on and so forth. And then the first thing Allah will ask you about people's rights, the blood. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade the blood and the money and property and the chastity of the believers. Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, the authentic hadith, إِنَّ دِمَاءَكُمْ وَأَمْوَالَكُمْ وَأَعْرَاضَكُمْ حَرَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. Indeed, your blood, this, you need to know the sacredness of life. The blood and the money and property and the chastity are haram. You cannot take anybody's life without right. You cannot steal anybody's property or money. You cannot insult anybody's chastity. If you do so, you will pay for this in the day of judgment. And the worst thing people will suffer from it in the day of judgment. If somebody has a lot of hasanat and he will not get benefit of it. I give you two examples of a person who did a lot of good deeds. His good deeds like mountains. His good deeds like mountains. You will see amount of good deeds like mountains. But Allah will make it worthless and fruitless. Why? The Prophet said, alayhi wasalam, because this person was hypocrite. He was doing these good deeds in front of people only. Once he's by himself, he doesn't worship. So Allah will not accept from him. So this is the deeds of the hypocrite person. Also, if a person owes people hasanat, he has a lot of deeds, mountains of deeds, but he owes people hasanat. The Prophet said, he asked the companions, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ الْمُفْلِسُ فِيكُمْ? Do you know who is the bankrupt amongst you? They said, the Messenger of Allah, the bankrupt is the one who has no money, no property. The poor person. The Prophet said, no, the real bankrupt is the one who has a lot of good deeds. A lot of good deeds in his lifetime. In the day of judgment, he has also in his book that he cursed this person and lashed in the back of this person, spread rumor about this person insulted this person, assaulted this woman. So this man will take his right. And we don't know how much they will take. Allah will evaluate. If you curse a prophet, it's not like cursing Abu Bakr. It's not like cursing Imam Abu Hanifa or Imam Malik. It's not like cursing somebody like me. It's not like cursing somebody like friend, or brother or sister. So everybody has value. If you violate somebody, Allah will evaluate the violation. Then he will take from your hasanat to satisfy the one who is wrong. So every person you cursed, you will pay from your hasanat. Every person you backbit, you will pay from your hasanat. Every person you smacked, you will pay from your hasanat. Every person you lashed his back, you will pay from his hasanat, from your hasanat. Imagine a person, he has a big wealth, hasanat like mountains, and he is paying everybody what he owes them until he becomes bankrupt. Imagine the soul. I did all this hasanat and lost it. I have all this wealth and I'm not able to enjoy it or to benefit from, and I will end punished in hellfire because of that. So it tells us when we do hasanat, we need to save our hasanat and to take our hasanat and not lose our hasanat. Because sometimes people do things that causes Allah to reject their deeds. For instance, Allah said in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَئِنْ أَحْبَطْتَ وَلَئِن أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ. If a person is doing a lot of good deeds, then he associated partners with Allah, Allah will make his previous deeds worthless. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said in Surah Al-Hujurat, this verse that I just mentioned in Surah Al-Zumar, in Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah said subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَنْ تَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالُكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. So people who are disrespecting the Prophet or raising their voices in his presence or speaking loud in his presence or yelling and screaming against his guidance, you may do this. So the consequence is Allah makes your deeds worthless. So you have a lot of hasanat, but Allah will tell you, you will not be benefited from this hasanat because you did this crime in dunya without repenting from it. So it's very important to take our deen serious. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, خُذُوا مَا أَتَيْنَاكُمْ بِقُوَّةٍ. Take what we have revealed to you strongly. Allah said also in the Quran, يَا يَحْيَا خُذِ الْكِتَابَ بِقُوَّةٍ. Oh Yahya, take the book strongly. Be serious about your deen. Allah did not create you to pay. Allah did not create you to fulfill your desires in dunya in haram way. Allah did not create you to favor this dunya over the akhirah. The rule is this. Take this, I will end with it. I know I made it very wrong, I'm sorry about that. One more verse from Surah Al-Isra. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعَاجِلَةِ عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا مَا نَشَاءُ لِمَنْ نُرِيدُ ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَا لَهُ جَهَنَّمْ يَصْلَاهَا مَذْمُومًا مَدْحُورًا. يعني whoever wants this word, the one who wants the worldly gain, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will rush for him whatever Allah wants to rush, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to give him. Then his final destination will be hellfire. If a person is favoring dunya over akhirah, so his end will be in hellfire. He said, وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. The one who his intention is الآخِرَةَ. Everything he's doing in dunya is for akhirah. He said, وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا. He's doing the means. He's doing his due diligence to achieve his goals. He said, فَأُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ سَعْيُهُمْ مَشْكُورٌ. Those people, Allah will be thankful to them. I want you to imagine this word, thankful. How Allah will be thankful to somebody. How Allah will appreciate somebody in the Day of Judgment. فَأُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ سَعْيُهُمْ مَشْكُورًا. Allah said, كُلَّا نُمِدْ هَوْلَا وَهُولَا. Those who want dunya will get dunya. Those who want akhirah will get akhirah. Allah will give those. And the Day of Judgment, everybody will face the consequence of his actions. As I told you, if you're going to read about the Day of Judgment, it's a book like this. If you're going to study the Day of Judgment and the details of it, you need a complete semester. It should be episodes every halaqa or episode is 2 hours or something. I'm just trying to give you a tour and a brief look to what is going to happen in the Day of Judgment. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. سبحانك اللهم ربنا وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والحمد لله رب العالمين.